you've got an eye on artificial intelligence. In fact, you have a new challenge offering up to $4 million to those who can help focus AI for good to tackle poverty. Just talk us through it.
Absolutely, and thank you so much for having me. Just yesterday, we had our Opportunity AI Summit, where we brought together over 450 people from technology, finance, data science, academia, public policy, to talk about the implications of artificial intelligence as both something that can be a positive force for good, as something that expands access to opportunity, but also as something that can, if not managed correctly, keep those who are left out of economic opportunity even farther behind. And one of the ways that we want to build energy around making sure that we're focused on opportunity is that we announced our amazing challenge, where we're going to put out the call for groups of technologists and social change organizations who can propose innovations in education, in the future of work, and in financial empowerment inclusion, where the winner will receive $1 million in each of those categories. So we'll have three winners, but we'll also have an additional set of nine finalists who can win $100,000. Yeah. And the idea is really to bring energy around this question and to make sure that this incredibly transformative tool, which is already not only changing the world, but it also captured the imagination of the world, making sure that that energy can be focused on ensuring that it becomes a force for social change and a force for economic inclusion.
Off the back of the big event, can you give us some takeaways of the ways in which you worry artificial intelligence could harm poverty, amplify poverty through indeed workforce, but also financial literacy and inclusion, and as you say, also education?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, one of the things that we when we talk about AI, we tend to either look at it from a incredibly optimistic lens, like it's going to be the thing that changes the world and life for everyone for the better, or through this dystopian lens where it's going to destroy the world. And I think in truth, as with any other technology, machine learning is a tool. And one thing that we know about technological innovation, although it can be the driver of great good, without management, it can truly leave people behind. And we see that across categories, even as recently as during the pandemic, where all of a sudden it became very critical for children. Speaking of education, it became so critical for children to have access to broadband just to be able to participate in the core in core educational schooling. But we saw in New York that a quarter of Black and Latino families, for example, lacked basic access to broadband. So it's one of these things where if you have access to technology, it can be a real driver of change. If you don't, it can leave you behind. You know, we are seeing in education right now tremendous use cases and innovation that have the potential to provide an individual tutor for every student, to provide coaching on how to write essays and edit essays. Amazing opportunity. But if schools serving low-income children don't have access to those tools, if the teachers in those classrooms don't have access to the training, if the schools don't have access to the technology, what we'll see is that these tools that can have a tremendous impact will further academic achievement for those who have access, but they can actually depress academic achievement for those who don't. And in a country where the achievement gaps between the rich and the poor, between people of color and white Americans remain persistent and strong. In New York, we see 40-point gaps, racial achievement gaps in basic in reading and writing and math. Making sure that this is a tool that helps move equity forward is critically important.
1.5 million New Yorkers live in poverty, and that's even since 1988. The Robin Hood Foundation has been, what, the number one local poverty tackling charity. I think $3 billion is already what you've raised. Where do you think this sort of skill set is going to come from? Everyone talks up the New York tech ecosystem, how that's been thriving, particularly post-pandemic. Are they going to be local entrepreneurs that you look to? Is it diversified? And can this be rolled out not just in New York, but more broadly?
Yeah, I mean, I think we are the best of both worlds in New York. One of the reasons that I'm so excited about the future, despite the potential challenges, is that here in New York, we have the perfect ecosystem to think about how all these tools can help move society for the better. World-class higher education, an amazing and growing tech industry, which is becoming really the engine that is driving our economy forward. Leaders in city and state government who are really committed to this work. You know, the governor recently announced Empire AI, a $400 million investment in basic research on artificial intelligence. So, you know, we have all the tools here. And so we think it's a great place to be a petri dish for innovation that can make a difference. But absolutely, we think anything we do here can have national implications. And indeed, the competition, the challenge we announced is open to everyone across the country. The one thing we ask is that there are clear implications and benefits to those of us who live in New York City, but we're hoping to hear from teams all over the country who have great ideas. And I think ideally there'll be teams that include people with lived experience in poverty, people in the community, nonprofit organizations, as well as technologists coming together and saying, here's a challenge in education and financial inclusion or in workforce, and here's a solution that we think can move the needle for the country and the world.